Okay, so welcome to today's lesson. My name is Kamwendo, and I'm going to talk about neonatal tetanus, which is a common condition you may have heard of, or you may have seen a particular baby experiencing this particular condition. So this is the condition that I'm going to talk about in pediatrics. So we'll go straight to look at what neonatal tetanus is. You'll find that this is just the introduction, but when it comes to tetanus, you'll find that it is most responsible for about 14% of neonatal deaths. And when you're talking of a neonate, meaning we are talking of a child who's under 28 days of life. And then apart from that, when it comes to the actual definition of neonatal tetanus, we can define neonatal tetanus as this is an infectious disease of the neonate affecting the nervous system. So this is an infectious disease of the neonate affecting the nervous system caused by the Clostridium tetani, and it is characterized by generalized body rigidity and fever. Apart from that, also a locked jaw. So when it comes to neonatal tetanus, it commonly affects the neonates or children. However, tetanus can also affect adults, especially those with a compromised immune system, sometimes even not those with a compromised immune system, but mainly it affects children. And when you talk of neonatal tetanus, meaning we are talking of tetanus affecting a child who's under 28 days of life. However, with neonatal tetanus, you'll find that this condition is very infectious. As a result, when it comes to management of this condition, you need to manage this particular child through infection prevention measures or outline. Apart from that, you'll find that when this child has the Clostridium tetani inside their body, this Clostridium tetani affects the nervous system, and we are going to talk about the pathophysiology of this condition and how the Clostridium tetani ends up reaching the nervous system, causing problems and manifestations such as generalized body rigidity because the nervous system has been compromised. Apart from that, the locked jaw, because you find that the facial nerves have been affected and then the jaw becomes fixed in one position. Apart from that, the child may also experience a raise in body temperature because of presence of the Clostridium tetani in the body. Then apart from that, when it comes to the Clostridium tetani itself, about its incubation period, on minimum or average, it is about 8 days, but it can range between 3 days rather to 21 days. But on average, you expect this child to start presenting with symptoms of tetanus within 8 days. When it comes to the port of entry, commonly in child, the entry of neonatal tetanus, of the Clostridium tetani rather, is through the umbilical stump. So you find that where maybe they have not used sterile instruments to cut the cord, it may be a port of entry, or even home deliveries, because they may not use sterile instrument, and where they're delivering this woman from may not be sterile, meaning that could be the port of entry of the Clostridium tetani through the umbilical stump of the baby. Apart from that, we have other factors such as lack of maternal vaccination. So you find that certain mothers may not be vaccinated with the tetanus toxoid vaccine. Hence, if they have tetanus, it may also end up affecting the child. Apart from that, anaerobic condition of the umbilical stump, you'll find that for the Clostridium tetani to multiply and increase in number, it does not need oxygen. Therefore, when there is an anaerobic condition through the umbilical stump, it may be a good harboring place for the Clostridium tetani. Apart from that, contamination, like I've said, maybe by application of non-sterile clay harboring the bacteria. Sometimes they may you may apply, or you have seen certain mothers applying cow dung on the umbilical stump. I don't know if it is done to promote faster falling of the umbilical stump or whatever reason it is done for, but you find that putting cow dung on the umbilical stump may introduce Clostridium tetani on the umbilical cord, and maybe a port of entry through which the Clostridium tetani finds itself into this particular child's body. This is just some notes on the characteristics of the Clostridium tetani and how it looks like. So this is just for you to try and understand how this the Clostridium tetani looks like, and by you knowing that it is mainly a gram-positive type of bacteria, and it is an anaerobic bacillus. Now, let us come to the important part of neonatal tetanus, which is the pathophysiology or disease progression. The first thing is that the tetanus occurs after spores of vegetative bacteria gains access to the tissue and produce toxins locally. So that's the first thing. The first thing is that you have this tetanus that is occurring because a spore of vegetative bacteria. And when we talk of spore-forming bacteria, an example of a spore-forming bacteria is the Clostridium tetani. And we'll look at how it results in tetanus because of it being a spore-forming bacteria. So once this gains access to the body tissue and produces toxins locally, there is a usual mode of entry through the punctured wound, or however it could be through an elective surgery, burns, or even after an abortion. Through these methods, a Clostridium tetani can enter through the body of this particular individual. But in pediatrics, when you talk of neonatal tetanus, the port of entry can be through the umbilical stump, which is mainly the common through which the Clostridium tetani gains access to the body of this particular baby. Now, the Clostridium tetani has entered the body of this particular baby through the umbilical stump. In the presence of anaerobic condition, the spore starts to germinate. So you find that this spore-forming bacteria will now start to germinate in a similar manner. When you plant seeds in your farm, either maize, beans, soya beans, or whatever you're planting, this is going to start germinating at some point with favorable condition, of course. That is why I always say that bacteria, they are smarter than human being, because bacteria, they are only going to germinate or reproduce when the conditions are favorable. But as human being, we reproduce even if the economy is very, very bad. People with the low socioeconomic status have hundreds of children as compared to those with a higher socioeconomic status. That's the reason why bacteria, they will never reproduce when conditions are not favorable, because meaning survival rate is reduced. So here we are saying, in the presence of anaerobic condition, the spores start to germinate. And these spores that start to germinate at the port of entry or at the site of entry, and in this particular case, we are saying the umbilical stump, the spores are going to transform into what is called a rod-shaped bacteria and produce a potent neurotoxin, which is known as a tetanospasmin toxin and a tetanolysin toxin. And these two toxins are what causes the effects of tetanus in an individual or a baby, and the effects that we talk about, such as a locked jaw, a body rigidity, it's because of presence of these two toxins in the body which causes this to happen. So from there, the toxin is inactive inside the bacteria, but when it dies, the toxin become activated. So when the Clostridium tetani gains access to the umbilical stump, it dies. Once it dies, it releases the two toxins which we have talked about, the two neurotoxins, which is tetanospasmin and tetanolysin. But these two cannot cause damage to the Clostridium tetani itself, because they are inactive when the Clostridium tetani is still alive or active. So once these toxins now are produced by the spore-forming bacteria, the toxins will now disseminate through the blood and also through the lymphatic system. However, it does not enter the central nervous system through this route, as it cannot cross the blood-brain barrier at the fourth ventricle. When you look at CSF circulation, CSF circulation has what are known as ventricles inside the brain, and this is the circulation through which blood is delivered to all parts of the brain to ensure that you remain active, because the brain is one organ which works throughout, even if you are sleeping, together with the heart, but the brain is to control all metabolic processes in the body. So we have what are known as lateral ventricles, the third ventricle and the fourth ventricle, through which even CSF now goes into the membranes of the central nervous system. So we are saying this particular toxin cannot cross the blood-brain barrier, but it does so by entering the blood, the central nervous system through the fourth ventricle. If you want to know where the fourth ventricle is located, be sure to go through the diagram of circulation of CSF, which can also be accompanied with this particular question. Then apart from that, once it enters the body through the blood-brain barrier at the fourth ventricle, the toxin is now taken up through to the neuromuscular junction. Now, the neuromuscular junction, get this scenario. You have neurons which come from the brain through the central nervous system, and you have the peripheral neurons. So when you have the spinal cord is known as the central nervous system. But from the spinal cord, you have neurons which innervates from the central nervous system, going to each and every particular muscle of the body, controlling the mechanisms that should take place in this particular body. This example I can give you, I'm speaking right now, is because my neurons are working properly and information is being disseminated nicely through the neurons and the muscles on which they innervate. So in this particular case, we are saying this particular Clostridium tetani is going to be taken up to the neuromuscular junction, meaning at the point where this neuron ends and is about to innervate on. Okay, so this is where now this particular Clostridium tetani, that is where it is going to settle, preventing neurotransmission between the neuron and the muscle that is supposed to receive the action. Then apart from that, cleaves or attaches itself to the membrane protein, which is involved in the neuroexocytosis and in turn blocks neurotransmission. So because it is sitting or it is attaching itself to the membranes, which are supposed to give a particular action to the muscle being innervated to, you find that neurotransmission is blocked. Hence, you are going to see now certain characteristics of symptoms arising. So the symptom, the toxin rather now acts after the incubation period of about 3 to 14 days. And on average, we said it is about 8 days at several sites within the central nervous system, including the motor end plate, as well as the spinal cord and the brain itself. And these toxins will now also interfere with the release of neurotransmitters and blocking inhibitor impulses. And now this is what leads to the loss of reflex control response to the afferent sensory stimuli. So afferent meaning the neurons that are supposed to give a particular response to a particular muscle that is innervated by the neuron bringing signals from the brain. And then you're going to see that there will be generalized muscle rigidity arising from an inhibited afferent stimuli. Because the muscles can't receive impulses, the muscle becomes rigid. They cannot respond to stimuli or to the environmental pressure. So these are just some of the diagrams that you can see, although not so much clear of how a particular child with tetanus may become, may have a rigid body. When it comes to signs and symptoms of neonatal tetanus, like we have mentioned, you may see a locked jaw. And the locked jaw, you find that there may be severe spasms, which usually starts from the jaw, causing difficulties in opening the mouth. And this is known as a locked jaw. And this is because there's increased spasms. That's why the jaw locks itself. Apart from that, irritability with a high-pitched sound may be seen. And this may be because of increased spasms, as well as a raise in body temperature causing irritability. Difficulties in feeding due to spasms of the muscles of the jaw. So you find that this is also what is known as trismus. So because of the spasms of the muscles of the jaw, this child is going to have difficulties in breathing. With this particular scenario, you find that one of the physical diagnostic tools for tetanus is that when you get a spatula, you press it behind the tongue or the mouth. The normal response is that you're supposed to vomit. Let's take this example. You're brushing your teeth and then you want to brush your tongue and you go beyond the mouth. You're going to feel the urge to vomit because that is the normal physiological response of the body. But in this particular case, when you have tetanus, when you try to push a spatula behind the tongue, you are going to bite the spatula because you have tetanus causing trismus, hence locking the jaws. So that is what happens. Apart from that, you find that the child has what is known as rhesus sardonicus, which is a devilish smile due to spasms of the muscles of the face. Then there is also epistotonus, which is the aching of the back with the head when the head is retracted. Apart from that, there is also convulsions, and this is because of inflammation occurring to the central nervous system, photophobia due to irritation of the optic nerve, respiratory imbalance due to spasms of the muscles of the respiration. That's why tetanus can also cause respiratory failure. The lungs may fail because impulses that the lungs are supposed to receive to breathe and breathe out are no longer being received because the tetanus Clostridium bacterium is blocking impulses to these particular structures. Apart from that, there may also be local signs of umbilical infection. You may see pus coming out of the umbilical cord, and this is due to invasion of the Clostridium tetani on the cord. And there's also a rise in body temperature due to presence of the Clostridium tetani in the blood. When it comes to management of tetanus, of course, you are going to start your management from medical management, then you go to nursing management. So when it comes to management outline, as usual, you need to have your aims, your aims or objectives. Then you come to medical management, you talk about at least 5 investigations. Then you can talk about other things. So when it comes to aims, you can talk about to prevent infections, to promote a quick recovery. Apart from that, to promote a patent airway, you can also talk about other investigations, other aims such as to prevent complications such as respiratory failure. So these and many other aims you can talk about, and then from there, your next heading is going to be medical management. So on medical management, the first heading under medical management is supposed to be investigations. And on investigation, the first point on investigation should be about history taking. So during history taking, there will be history of contamination on delivery, such as use of unsterilized instruments. Apart from that, there may also be other points on history, but only one point is required for you in this particular case. Then the next point should be a physical examination point, and you can say during physical examination, the child will present with a rising body temperature and a locked jaw. So you can't just say a raise in body temperature, because a raise in body temperature may signify different condition. But when you quantify it with a locked jaw, you'll find that this now makes sense. It may easily direct you to tetanus. Then apart from that, now you can do other investigations such as labs or radiologicals. So you can do an umbilical stump swab. And this is done for culture and sensitivity reactions, which will reveal presence of Clostridium tetani. Then apart from that, when you get blood, it will reveal leukocytosis, increased levels of leukocytes in the blood. Apart from that, other investigations can also be done. So other investigations can also be done, such as when you get the same blood, you can also get blood for culture and sensitivity reaction apart from the swab itself. And apart from that, you can also get blood to rule out meningitis, because meningitis may also cause similar symptoms as a differential diagnosis. So you are getting blood to rule out meningitis, or even cerebral malaria can be done to rule it out. So these are some of the investigations that can be done in case where you want to come up with a diagnosis for tetanus rather. Then when it comes to treatment, in terms of treatment, you can give drugs such as benzyl penicillin as an antibiotic, which is commonly used to treat or to manage tetanus. So benzyl penicillin, you can give 5,000 rather international units, QID, and you give it preferably IV 4 times a day for 5 days. You can also give erythromycin 125 milligrams QID. This one you can also give it IV for 5 days as well, and preferably IV. But then the only specific drug that you can give is the tetanus toxoid. So the anti-tetanus toxoid, which will give 250 international units, and you can give it IM so that it helps neutralize the toxins so that there is less harm done to the motor neuron. So you need to write also the mode of action of these drugs that I've mentioned, side effects, as well as the nursing implication for you to get the full marks for each drug mentioned. But in cases of convulsions, you can also give Valium, but those drugs that we have mentioned on top are drugs given to treat or kill the bacterium. Then these drugs are being given to manage symptoms arising from the condition. So you can give Valium, which is diazepam, to reduce on the spasms or convulsions, or you can also give, in place of Valium, you can give clopromazine. Okay, then in terms of the nursing, so you are done, meaning at that particular point, you are done with the medical management, then you move on to the nursing management. So when it comes to the nursing management, as usual, you're going to start with, you write your heading as nursing management, then the next point is going to be infection prevention. So all conditions which impair the airway, but they are infectious, you start them in this same particular manner. So you're going to start with the patient isolation rather, and on patient isolation, you're going to say, I'll nest the baby in a side ward within the neonatal intensive care unit or the infection ward if at all it is there. Then apart from that, you can say, I'll label the isolation room to prevent easy access from the general ward, so that meaning everyone in the ward should not just walk freely in this particular ward. By labeling it, it avoids or reduces individuals just walking in directly without precautions. Apart from that, you can ensure that the environment is warm enough so as to prevent hypothermia. You can also talk about the environment having good lighting for easy observation. You can talk about the environment also having dust-free environment so that you prevent nosocomial infections. And you can talk about other points in the isolation room that you can talk about, such as even having necessary resuscitative instruments for use whenever needed. Then from there, you can move on to infection prevention as the next heading. And on infection prevention, you can talk about hand washing before and after handling the patient to prevent the transfer of infections. You can talk about points such as sterilizing or decontaminating and sterilizing instruments being used on this particular child, so that you prevent the spread of infection. Apart from that, you can talk about use of personal protective equipment or instruments such as gowns and gloves to prevent the transfer of infections. You can talk about wearing masks. You can talk about frequent hand sanitizing to prevent transfer of infection, and other infection preventative measures, you can still use them. Then from infection prevention, this condition can affect the airway. So you can now bring in ABCs. So you can talk about promoting a patent airway. So on promoting a patent airway, you can say if there is symptoms of respiratory failure, I will ensure that I suction so as to promote a patent airway. You can also talk about repositioning the baby so for free flow of secretions. Apart from that, you can also use a tongue depressor to prevent the tongue from falling behind and blocking the airway. So these and any other points can still be added on promoting a patent airway. Apart from that, then you can go to promoting adequate breathing. So in terms of promoting adequate breathing, you can say, I will check for oxygen saturation levels. If below 90%, I will give supplemental oxygen. You can also talk about giving oxygen 1 to 2 liters per minute of oxygen to promote tissue perfusion. Apart from that, you can give air using an AmbuBag to promote lung perfusion. Again, these and any other point, you can talk about them. But in this particular case, you don't say I'll nest the baby in a well-ventilated environment such as opened windows, because this is a neonate and neonates are prone to hypothermia. Then from there, you can talk about circulation. Remember, circulation is going to promote also recovery by improving circulation to major organs and also making sure that the baby is alive. So in this particular case, you can give normal saline, 5 mL per kg body weight, so as to promote circulation. You can also give dextrose for energy if the child looks lethargic or weak because it can't feed, so you need to give it dextrose, also dextrose 10% for energy, so that the body can use this dextrose for metabolic purposes. You can also give Ringer's lactate, that is if there is electrolyte imbalance, and therefore Ringer's lactate can be given. Then apart from that, you can ensure that on circulation, if the baby is able to breastfeed, which may not be the case because of the locking of the jaw, you can also give breast milk, but we'll talk about it in nutrition, where you now talk about inserting a nasogastric tube. So those points, you can talk about them when it comes to the ABCs. Then from there, you can now bring in cardinal headings from a profenema. So when it comes to the profenema, you can bring in cardinal headings. The environment headings may have been swallowed on the heading for isolation, so no need to bring in such a heading. When it comes to rest, yes, we can talk about it, but not so cardinal, as well as position, because the baby may not have any other significant position because it is too small. But observations, very cardinal. So you can observe the general condition of the child in order to determine whether the child is responding to medical care or not. Apart from that, you can also check the vitals, such as the temperature, pulse, respirations, and just those for baseline data. So temperature to monitor infection, pulse to monitor cardiovascular function, and respirations to rule out respiratory failure. You can also observe the child's tolerance to light in order. Apart from that, you can also observe the feeding pattern of the child, whether the locked jaw is continuous affecting the child's feeding pattern or not, because this may predispose the child to nutrition in deficiency. In deficiencies. Then apart from that, you can give psychological care to the mother. So in terms of giving psychological care to the mother, you need to explain the condition to the mother, allow the mother to ask a question, involve the mother in the care of the baby. And all this is being done to promote, to allay anxiety, as well as promoting cooperation. You can allow the mother to ask questions and also perform related procedures in blocks, so that also the child can have enough time to rest from the stress of procedures. But you need to involve the mother as you do this procedure, so that in case anything goes wrong, the mother should have been there or is there to say, okay, the nurse did the right thing and everything according to their responsibilities. Then apart from psychological care to the mother, you can talk about nutrition, things like nutrition. So in terms of nutrition, you can say if the child is unable to feed by mouth due to a locked jaw, I'll insert a nasogastric tube and give expressed breast milk. But as the condition of the child improves, I'll ensure that the mother provides oral feeding, so that the child can have the nutrition status of the child can be promoted. You can also give 5% dextrose parentally. Then in terms of hygiene, you can do interventions for hygiene, such as eye swabbing with normal saline to prevent eye damage. You can do cold care, especially newborn, to minimize or prevent infections. But you can also apply spirited swabs and keep the umbilical stump dry at all times. You can also perform oral care when necessary to keep the mouth clean and prevent oral sepsis, as the mouth may be open due to contraction of the muscles of the face. So these are some of the interventions that you can talk about in terms of nutrition. Okay. Then apart from that, you can talk about other things such as you can remove other things such as exercises, not so cardinal because this is a baby. Then when it comes to medication, you can say, I'll ensure that the child is receiving prescribed drugs or is being given prescribed drugs such as benzyl penicillin or Cipro, or apart from that, any other prescribed drug, including paracetamol for fever. I will explain to the mother the importance of giving the child these drugs, their side effects, and the complications that may arise if these drugs are not given to the child. So on medication, those points are enough. Then apart from that, now we can talk about elimination. You need to observe the output and compare it to the input so that you rule out overload or dehydration, and also check if that or the child is able to pass feces, which is the meconium, if at all the child passed the meconium or not, because the Clostridium tetani may also affect nerves that innervate the GI tract, as a result, making it impossible for peristaltic movements to take place, and the child may not be able to pass stool when you have been feeding this particular child. So, in terms of the management of Clostridium of tetanus, rather, that is how you can manage tetanus. Some of the complications that may be seen in tetanus, you may see respiratory failure arising because of muscle spasms. Apart from that, it could be because of obstruction of the airway by oral secretions, as well as pulmonary aspiration as the child is trying to breathe. Apart from that, there could be cardiac complications such as a raise in terms of the heartbeat or the pulse because of the hyperactiveness of the sympathetic nerve system. There may be asphyxia because there's impairment in oxygen supply to the lungs, hence making it difficult for the child to initiate and sustain breaths. There may be brain damage as a complication because of one, reduced oxygen supply to the brain. Apart from that, also because of severe inflammation occurring because of invasion of the Clostridium tetani into the central nervous system. So these and other complications may arise or may be seen in tetanus. So this is where we'll end with tetanus, and these are just ways through which you can prevent tetanus. So when you're giving advice on discharge to the mother, you can give such information to the mother, not to the child. The child won't be able to understand anything, but this particular information can be given to the mother so that in subsequent births or child deliveries, you advise the mother to deliver from the hospital where everything should be done correctly and in a particular order. So this is where we are going to end with the tetanus.